I'm Sean McCarthy, product manager in the video technology group at Viacom CBS, where our team is focused on building products that help optimize video QoE. I'm sure many in the audience have dealt with QoS issues and struggled to triangulate the root cause. Or perhaps you were able to identify a CDN as the culprit, and the only path forward was to open a support ticket and wait. Hopefully, within 10 or so minutes, you get a response that includes more than a ticket number and an additional list of questions for you to answer. But in the likely case you're stuck providing more details while viewers tune out of your service, you're probably wishing you were able to investigate the issue on your own. This is why we built Visor. And yes, we got the okay from Captain Pike to use that logo. Visor is a real-time, end-to-end stream observability platform, primarily focused on CDN data, which is intended for a content owner's operations team to troubleshoot QoS issues. We do this by collecting the raw access logs of a stream from signal acquisition out to the player. Visor is not a syslog monitoring solution intended to debug workflow components like disk failures or CPU usage, but rather to surface the components that might be experiencing an issue in the context of video stream data. Today, I'd like to talk to you a bit about the platform and the lessons we learned building it. As we began understanding the problem space, it became clear we needed to surface data in as real time as possible, reduce the mean time to diagnose and mitigate delivery issues, and simplify the workflow of operations teams. It was also vital we be able to scale to support the log load generated from up to 10 million concurrent viewers, which was the upper estimate of what we were expecting for Super Bowl. With these goals in mind, we were able to begin architecting the platform. Leading up to the event, we were most concerned with testing the platform under realistic load. But the problem was, there was no event which even came close to the scale we were anticipating for Super Bowl. Because of this, we couldn't rely on production data to stress test the platform, so we decided to generate synthetic load by developing an in-house tool. That's how DIRT, or the Data Ingest Replay Tool, was born. As the name suggests, the tool re-ingests saved data, and we generate additional load by replicating rows, swapping around values, and adding unique now time values to the timestamp column. DIRT seemed great in theory, but after hitting a number of cloud resource limitations, we decided we needed to deploy in dedicated infrastructure or as close to bare metal servers as possible. We weren't really prepared to manage our own Kubernetes cluster and all the overhead that came with it, so this is just a warning for anyone who plans to test a similar system at this scale. It's a lot of work. We eventually replicated the load of 18 million concurrent viewers and successfully ingested the data within 2 minutes. So it seemed like our platform was ready for production. We built some rudimentary dashboards showing edge errors, total bandwidth, and some player metrics, and then identified some NFL playoff games to dry run the system and start focusing more on the data and less on the platform. Well, we were in our test playoff WarZoom just before kickoff, monitoring both the video stream data and the platform data, and everything was looking good. But just as concurrent viewers began to increase, our query time also increased until all of a sudden the dashboards wouldn't load. We had successfully supported the load of 18 million concurrents in testing, so why would this happen on an event with a fraction of the viewers? Well, I wanted to explain this with some fancy graphs that break down all the platform performance metrics, but that could easily be a whole presentation in and of itself. So here's a very crude and oversimplified abstraction of what happened, which I'm sure our DevOps engineer, Misha, is rolling his eyes at. What I'm showing here is when we're not running queries, there's pretty much a linear relationship between the cloud resources consumed and the amount of data coming in. But as soon as we ran even a small number of queries, along with the increasing ingest load, that relationship became exponential and we overloaded the database. This was partially expected given the complexity of the queries, but the nature of CDN log data was certainly another factor. So because of this, we had a few more platform items to address before diving into the data itself. We needed to optimize the queries for performance, as well as implement automated ways to heal the system if it fell into a bad state. This included a query killer and functionality to sample or turn off data sources altogether. Another takeaway was the need to implement a leader-follower database architecture, wherein the leader would be primarily responsible for ingesting data and then forward the data to a follower for querying. We didn't have the perfect platform, but we had safety levers to pull if things went south, as well as a clear path forward to optimize. So I think this is a good segue into a portion of the presentation that's a bit more interesting than the infrastructure stuff, and that's our data takeaways. With all the focus on scaling the platform to support massive load, we needed to take a step back and ask ourselves if unsampled data was really required for effective monitoring. We decided to experiment with sampling, and the results were in line with what our CDN vendors pretty much told us from the beginning. Sampling works, and there was very little added benefit in collecting every log line. We found that CDNs offer a representative data sample. We have log lines represented from all relevant dimensions, and we were not able to identify any glaring blind spots. And CDNs also support a conditional if statement, allowing users to specify the conditions under which they sample. So capturing 100% of non-200 responses is a pretty standard condition. This is great if you're tracking error counts and not just rates, or if you have unique status codes you're concerned with. Not sampling cache misses is also a good idea if you plan on tracing requests. If you're using a shielding layer, which is also serving edge traffic like we are, then delineating the shield requests from the edge requests and not sampling the shield values is also a good idea. The key takeaway here is we found we could sample upwards of 80% of data and still catch relevant trends and 100% of potentially problematic requests. So what else did we learn about unnecessary data? Well, we needed to explore what data sources actually required raw logs. We assumed we wanted raw logs wherever available, but as we began provisioning more data sources, we realized we only really need raw logs where it added value. To start, there were several data sources which didn't even support exposing raw access logs. So for those, we were limited to pulling their APIs. When it came to encoder telemetry, we couldn't compete with the access our engineers had detailing the logs, and we didn't want to bog down encoder performance by publishing logs in real time, so we settled for collecting congestion alarms and encoder events. I'd also point out here, we're proposing a standardized live encoder beacon spec in a sheet that I'll share later on in the presentation. It's nothing we've implemented yet, but we greatly appreciate any feedback on what we've put together. So if you're interested, please feel free to access the sheet and add comments. At one point, we collected a raw fire hose of data from monitoring tools and soon realized the tool vendors were a lot better at generating metrics from their data than we were. So we collected those from their APIs. But what about player data? The real problem we were trying to solve by collecting raw player beacons was the ability to couple the client-side data with the CDN logs for request tracing. And to be clear, this meant aggregating the beacons in Visor directly from the player, bypassing any server-side processing an analytics provider would typically perform before exposing the data. And that's a lot of data, a real lot of data. Just so we could get some more dimensionality we thought we wanted, and so we could take on the burden of deriving our own metrics. Let's take a look at just rebuffering, for example. Although we would receive a rebuffer start and a rebuffer end event with a timestamp and calculate rebuffering, our calculation substantially overstated overall rebuffering because of a delay that we didn't control from when the end event was generated on the client and when it was sent out. We really didn't have the numbers necessary to compensate for these timing delays, and even if we did, they'd be very expensive queries to run. So we eventually decided to give up collecting raw player beacons in favor of hitting an aggregate API. So there really were only two workflow components which require raw logs, CDNs and Live Origin. But we still struggled with coupling CDN and client-side data. So to address that, we've begun implementing the common media client data spec, which allows for session-specific player stats to be coupled with CDN logs. So for those who aren't familiar with CMCD, it's essentially a way to share player data with CDNs and trigger certain functionality like prefetch, better informed bandwidth throttling, or in our case, simply injecting the data into the CDN logs we were already collecting for visibility. This reduces our need to run expensive join operations because each CDN log line is appended with the CMCD data. It provides key insights into player health at the time of each request and allows us to string them together with a unique session ID. For our implementation of CMCD, we're passing the data in a query string parameter, which we're already logging, and then just parsing that field out at ingest time. So the metrics we decided were most valuable for our first iteration are shown here. And having these additional fields in our CDN logs makes the data more valuable and is a decent substitute for what we were trying to do with collecting the raw player beacons. How about request tracing? A major benefit of working with logs is having the ability to trace requests through the CDN to the origin. We do this by capturing a client request ID at the edge and including it in the Media Shield forward request header. We can then log it on the Media Shield and create one common request ID between CDN and Shield. To account for the origin requests, we also log the origin request ID in the response header returned to Media Shield. So by logging these UUIDs, we can trace the entire request from edge to origin and correlate the logs. Another layer to consider is the fact many CDNs have multi-tier caching. It's an architecture that not all of the CDNs use, but basically before a request even reaches an origin or shielding layer, it'll be forwarded to a mid-tier CDN machine or a peer machine. Most CDNs are not exposing these logs, nor would we necessarily want the entire log lines, but we are working with CDNs to include specific information from these mid-tier requests, such as, you know, a string of IPs that the request was forwarded to, and either a TTLB metric or a timestamp at each hop. There's an SVA distributed request tracing initiative, which aims to standardize how this is done. The general framework of sharing the request ID via headers seems to be the approach they're talking about. So we look forward to seeing how we can modify our approach as the spec becomes more defined. So moving along, one of the biggest data challenges by far has been normalizing metrics and understanding how logs vary between vendors. CDNs use different field naming, have different definitions, and don't always expose all the same fields as one another. I've captured a lot of the differences in a doc linked here. This is the same sheet I mentioned earlier, which has the encoder beacon spec as well, if anyone's interested. We wanted to make sure the way that we're thinking about CDN data is as publicly available and collaborative as possible. So we shared this doc with several industry groups like the CDN Alliance, the CDNs themselves that are represented in it, and companies who maintain data dictionaries of their own, like DataZoom. In addition to the fields which vary between CDNs, there are metrics we derive from this data which require a bit more logic. These include things like client aborts, mapping distance, origin retries, origin offload, or even an abstraction of the various cache statuses into a simple cache true or false Boolean. Deriving these sorts of metrics varies greatly between CDNs, and we could take a look at one example here. Having the ability to filter requests which ended in a client closing a browser or an app is a really good metric for us to track, either as a server-side proxy for content issues or a metric to filter out from other queries. So, for example, how would these requests impact TTLB? Well, for Fastly, if a client request does not complete the connection, then a 503 is logged at the configured timeout value, unless streaming misses enable on your services. In that case, the HTTP status may be a 200 with a separate field called completed, reporting as false. In the case of CloudFront, requests will always be a cache miss and can have a really high time to last byte. So that can greatly impact, it could, you know, exceed your timeout value and really greatly impact turnaround times on cache misses that were forwarded to Shield or Origin. The takeaway here is, it takes time to find all these nuances, and queries become increasingly complex as you add additional CDNs to your workflow. So now that you understand a bit more about Visor and the challenges we faced building it, you may be wondering, was it worth it? Was the overhead of building this tool worth the effort, and were we actually able to have an impact on bottom line QoS? Well, we were able to successfully support Super Bowl 55, which saw a record 5.7 million viewers. And we were able to get to the root cause of an issue, which was contributing to rebuffering prior to a CDN even noticing the issue. And they actually used Visor in real time to troubleshoot the issue. So a little bit about the Super Bowl issue. We saw an increase in 504s for one CDN vendor, determined they were all served from one pop and it happened to be one of the most heavily trafficked pops. many of the 504s had a TTLB lower than the client timeout value, and they were served for, as cash hits, so this was a bit puzzling. We purged the cache, and the 504 rate went way down, but shortly after, it began increasing again, so we decided to remove the CDN from rotation. The CDN vendor used Visor to get some sample 504 cache miss log lines, which happened to not have a corresponding media shield log. They eventually concluded that the pop was overloaded, and the two-second origin timeout was met before the requests even made it to the shield. So that explained why there was no shield log. The issue was exacerbated because the 504s were being incorrectly served from cache. The conclusion here is we were able to catch 504s before rebuffering increased, move traffic as soon as rebuffering did increase, and were able to isolate the issue to a particular pop, providing the CDN vendor data showing the pop was running hot, the 504s were served from cache, and there were no corresponding timeouts on the shield. So I'd say the platform did its job, and it continues to help us learn more about CDN behavior and ways of optimizing our overall streaming workflows every day. So now, thank you guys for listening to my presentation. I really want to give a shout out to the engineering team who put all the effort to make Visor a success. So thanks, everyone. Look forward to answering questions.